Good morning. I'm Bob Boyers of Salmagundi Magazine, and I'm delighted to chair this morning's session on the little magazine today. Our four speakers are Jon Baskin of The Point. We're going from this side, right? Rachel Rosenfelt. Sorry? Even closer than this.
Yeah, no, it makes it sound more important.
It's very hard. Authority is not my strong suit, to put it, or my weak suit for that matter. Jon Baskin of The Point, Rachel Rosenfelt of New Inquiry, Sam Lavigne of Uselessness, Press. of Uselessness Press.org.
We're changing the name.
Yeah.
And Alix Rule next to him.
Alix.
Got it.
And it's Sam Lavigne.
Sorry?
Sam Lavigne.
Well, see, this is the speakers from the new magazines, and I'm from the very old magazines. So forgive my mispronunciation of the names. I'm going to pitch some questions, they will be broad questions that can be taken up by all the speakers or by one or two of the speakers as they prefer. And since I have a good number of questions prepared, all of which seem to me somewhat relevant to the subject we want to talk about, I'm sure that everyone will find some of these questions attractive to respond to. My first one really has to do with something that comes out of my own experience in starting a magazine. I had a mentor, a much older man, at the New School, who was the dean of the New School back at the time. He was the dean here in the 50s, and I met him in the very early 60s. He was a founding editor of Irving Howe's Dissent magazine. He was on the editorial board of that magazine right until his death in the early 1980s. He was a man named Henry Pachter. And as I got to know him when I was very, very young, he encouraged me to start a magazine. And basically, the encouragement had to do with his sense that the magazine he ran with Irving Howe and a couple of other people, Dissent, and a few other magazines on the left, like the Partisan Review, which was the most influential of magazines in those days on the left, were magazines that in some way needed to be, he felt, combined in some way into a single magazine, which would address politics and things in the way that they were addressed in Dissent, but would have a very strong emphasis on the arts and literature and culture, such as you found in the pages of the Partisan Review. So there was a sense in which I thought of starting a magazine, not in the sense of following a blueprint, but in the sense of setting up, at least in opposition to or as an alternative to already existing magazines. I wanted to have a sense that there was a thing that I might accomplish. And so I thought to put as a first question to the panel, is there any informing sense of your direction or mission that resembles that in any way? You think about what your magazine can do, what you want it to do. Anyway, an opener.
Want me to start?
Yeah,
well, of course, you'd like to say yes. I think that when you start a magazine, in a way, you don't know until you've come out with a couple issues if you really do have something different to say. You know, it starts with just you have these articles and no one else will publish them. You have to kind of, but I think for us, I mean, so for me, my introduction to little magazines was obviously much later. It was basically there was McSweeney's and there were a lot of sort of fiction and arts magazines. And then N plus one came along. I remember going to their initial party in 2005. Is that what, And, you know, N plus one did something that was, it wrote with a kind of seriousness in the essay form about ideas that was very attractive to me and was something that I didn't feel like other people were doing that much at the time. And so there was certainly a part of me that when we started the point, we had N plus one in mind in certain ways in terms of the tone and the, you know, the kind of audience we wanted to reach. But I guess we felt like, how would I say what the point, I mean, the point, I guess one thing the point felt was missing even from little magazine culture was what I might call like a sort of more philosophical approach to ideas and to culture, leaving it as a real open question, what was good, what the good life was, what was good about a certain art form or a certain political movement or a certain orientation towards something like parenting or relationships. I think we felt like even on in a lot of little magazines, that question, there was sort of a constrained amount of answers you could have to that question, often by politics. And we wanted to see if we could start a magazine where these were really thought of as open questions. And that was what we hoped to do. You know, I can't say to what extent we've been successful, but that's what you hope. That was sort of the gap I think we hoped to fill.
So I sort of, a few weeks ago, I guess, spoke to this at the U.S. Intellectual History Conference, where I was invited to speak about little magazines. And when I was preparing for that talk, I was looking at, you know, what exactly defines a little magazine? What do we mean when we say little magazines? I mean, a big question for me was that New Inquiry is not in print and never, I hope, never will be in print. I mean, it's a central characteristic of what the experiment is. And in that sense, it's quite big, technically, for a little magazine. And it also most little magazines come out sort of with a sense of purpose. And that's something that's very alien to me. I can't imagine. Can't imagine the arrogance of, no, I mean, I just can't imagine what it would mean to sort of set out to do something ambitious like that. When I started the New Inquiry, there was, and you can find ghost accounts of it on every single internet platform that could possibly be made an account of in 2008. And then when it started taking off, just, and it could have been, it's actually legally defined as physical space in our 501c3. It could have been anything. It was just more about organizing a public that was permeable between the readers and writers. And so it wasn't just this cohort of writers or a literary vanguard or political vanguard that was then broadcasting. It was more, you know, about creating a porous space, which is not to say a free-for-all. There was certainly a very high bar that was collectively set by the people that got involved. But, I mean, I remember a few years into it, somebody said to me, oh, this is sort of like N plus one. Like, what do you... And I was like, what's N plus one? And I thought, you know, I was reading about the Partisan Review and I'm like, this, people should do this again, you know, and I sort of, it was out of just like, you know, the sort of power of sheer ignorance that kind of led it to be what it was. And I guess I would sort of throw out, now when we can talk about it later, I think there is a coherent political purpose. And I think New Inquiry has actually defined a space of where academic writing and writing for the public sort of very naturally meet, which wasn't the case when we started. But that's something that's happened and it's been kind of co-created over the years. So at the inception, no idea, and yet through the sheer force of days behind it, it's actually become something that occupies a unique space.
Okay, I'll start. Yeah. So, I mean, I guess the first thing to say is, like, I'm not sure that Useless Press is actually a magazine. I mean, is it a magazine? Do you think it's a magazine?
No, I mean, I think that, like, what so much closer, yeah. I think that what John said, I mean, it must be right for all projects, right? You start them and you don't really know what they are. And in this case, we're really new, and we definitely have no idea what we are.
But we could say something, right.
We might be in a little magazine because we're here.
right. But so what we do is we don't actually publish articles. We publish sort of online projects, like interactive projects. And every month we work with like a new artist or a new person who isn't us, and we like, you know, help them achieve some ambitious, strange online project type of goal. Sure. Yeah, I can give you some examples. So some of the things we've done so far is we worked with this guy Daniel Kolitz to make like a sort of like full reproduction of Facebook's interface out of printed and collaged materials. So it's this whole like sort of fake Facebook feed with like a series of fake Facebook articles. It's very satirical. And it's this kind of like universe that you're entering when you go to the website.
It's fully interactive though. So yes. While it was made out of and appears to be made out of collaged paper, Sam built an entire mirror interface of Facebook, so you can click through it and the right. sort of narrative unfolds.
Right, like you go to a New York Times article and then like the New York Times like fake paywall comes up, you know, and like it's like stuff like that. And then I don't know, we made a thing. It's like a phone line that you call. It puts you on hold for 7 years and it tracks how long you've been on hold for. And then there's like a leaderboard of who's waited the longest on the website. I'll give two more very, very brief examples. We are tracking what world leaders are doing and then using machine learning to predict what they're going to do next. And then we send them alternate recommendations for courses of action on Twitter. So they get like a little note like, you know, this week we predict you're going to like, you know, assassinate someone. Instead, we suggest that you make a phone call. You know? And then the last project that we did was with this novelist, Joshua Cohen, and we asked him to write a novella in real time over the course of 5 days. So like you'd go to this website and you'd see what he was typing, like kind of like looking at someone's Google Doc, right? And then you'd see his little face, and and there was an anonymous chat room where people were mostly just trolling him, actually, and sort of saying weird things to him over chat. So those are the kinds of things that we do. And like each project is like, you know, there's like a large technical component to each project. So part of what we're trying to achieve is like work with people who don't have a technical background and sort of help them realize something that they wouldn't be able to do on their own. Now I've talked so long about what we do that I actually can't remember what the question was. But do you have anything else to...
While you do it.
Yeah. Well, did we do it in order to be able to say that we're not doing something else, I think? Is that a sure. fair paraphrase of the question?
What are we responding to, I guess?
Exactly. Or what were we not when we...
Well, there's two things I think that like all of our projects have in common. Like one is the way that they treat data. So there's all this stuff around data lately and like an attempt to like use data to make truth claims about the world, you know. And I think what we're trying to do with almost all of our projects is use data to do something stupid, you know, basically, right? You know, to critique data in some ways, like the way that we encounter data. And then there's kind of like a broader narrative in my head about like what's going on the internet right now and how much the internet sucks right now. I mean, for lack of a better word, and trying to like actively like make projects that like recall a time in the internet where more things were possible.
I just wanted to just say my interpretation of it, if I may, just to sort of like get it off the ground. No, I think that like, you know, one of the, like I recommended Sam and Alix participate in this panel because I think a real important question to ask is, has the political essay reached its apex as a form? You know, the political essay, we talk about the New York intellectuals and we are constantly quoting Irving Howe in every one of these kinds of panels I've been to. And I think that what Sam and Alix are doing have the effect of a political essay. I think they have, there are arguments and there are conclusions to draw, but they're not formally an essay. And so then the question is this a little magazine? If New Inquiry is a little magazine, or if online magazines are a little magazine, how is this not also a little magazine? And it's just taking a different form than the essay to make its point.
I'm not sure. I mean, you know, I think the, I mean, I really like referring to the project's use and engagement with, like, with data and, like, the tools of, like, data analysis and, like, web design, and this sort of suite of technical tools that we can play around with now. Like, I like the characterization as stupid, but so this will maybe be, like, a little bit more of, like, a kind of, like, oblique response to this question. Like, I think, like, stupid, useless, like, essayistic, poetic, critical, like, they could all be synonyms. In other words, you know, like, using these, like, technical tools to make something that is not self-avowedly either efficiency oriented or scientific, you know, mm-hmm. is like, I think one way that we think about the project. And you know, so does that like resonate with what's in your imagination for Use the Press? I don't know.
I'm going to jump in because to me it seems you're trafficking in satire to assign the genre. And satire has a long distinguished pedigree, and it's a specific form of intervening in a discourse and a conversation. But before you came, I said, I thought it was the Mad Magazine of little magazines. And he said he'd never heard of Mad Magazine.
Well, let me follow up with a question that grows out of what you've all just said. I think maybe begin with Sam and Alix, if I may. How do you decide which projects to take on, which kinds of people you want to work with? Do they come to you? Do they offer you projects the way people send unsolicited materials to more conventional magazines? Do you go out and find people that you want to work with and commission them to do things and that sort of thing? Just to get started on that.
Bob, you have to stay close to the microphone.
Sorry about that.
Definitely staying close to the microphone. So both. And like, actually the simplest answer to this is like, you know, from a kind of organizational perspective, we're trying to be structured like a little magazine, right? Like we both take unsolicited submissions and reach out to people and try and commission things, and maybe they cooperate or maybe they have something else to do because you know, they have day jobs and they, you know, it's in that sense, it's just like a little magazine. But the difference, of course, is that, you know, New York is a place full of self-identified writers who have habits of, you know, sending unsolicited submissions to magazines, some of which pay them sometimes, some of which don't. So there's this whole, you know, there's the whole ecology that exists around literary, political, whatever, magazines in the more recognizable form that doesn't exist for us. So I think to me, like part of the interesting part of the project, right, is just, you know, it is just being like, is the gambit of being like, can this be a community? You know, will people like identify themselves as potential contributors to this bizarre project? Do you have?
No, I think you summed it up like really well, because like one of the things that we're dealing with is like what exactly is the thing that we're making, like what each piece, what is it, like how do we describe it to people, you know, in a way that's like clear, and they can be like, oh, I have like an idea for something I can do there that fits into what we've already done.
John, I thought maybe you might jump in here a little bit and talk somewhat about this. I mean, for some magazines, there is a sort of an ongoing question about the relationship between solicited and unsolicited material. I know in our magazine, we went through at a certain point a considerable soul searching because we'd become accustomed to soliciting material again and again and again from a fairly wide range of trusted people, and we wanted to keep the magazine open to unsolicited material, and the only way to really seriously keep it open to unsolicited material was basically not only to tell people they could send, but also to often accept some of the work, so that there were new, fresh voices coming into the mix. And anyway, I wonder. Your magazine obviously is a magazine that could very, very well exist with almost entirely or perhaps entirely commissioned material. So how do you sort of think about that?
Well, for a lot of our magazine's existence, it was hard to commission material because we didn't pay. So we've always been, for a while we were, well, in the beginning you published, it was mostly by people we knew that published things. But we've always been happy to get unsolicited stuff, and we still take a lot of it. I think it's always a mix. As we've been able to obviously offer money, we have more control over, you know, going after more writers and writers from different places, and that's been good for the diversity of the magazine. But I don't know that I have anything more interesting to say in terms of, I think it's the normal process of sort of a mix of trying to identify subjects and writers that we definitely want covered, but also being open to new things that come in unsolicited.
Same way, Rachel.
Oh, sure. I think the New Inquiry, and I mean, I should say that I'm no longer the editor-in-chief of the New Inquiry. I was for many years, and I'm the founder of it. For me, and maybe for me alone, and not as much for the people involved, New Inquiry was less of an ambition or less of a vision of what would be produced than the form that it would take to produce anything at all. And so, rather than being a cohort of people who kind of already knew each other and had this idea to do this magazine and wrote and published each other, it was at a certain point just me, and finding a way to basically have the magazine grow exponentially through one, soliciting people to be involved, and then allowing them to solicit other people, and then for the sensibility to sort of to organically take form. And then turns out, you know, a huge amount of what we publish is submissions based, because it began to occupy a space that just didn't exist before, and it was very much a space where it's authentically that people have told me that live all over the world that they felt by submitting to New Inquiry that there wasn't some group of people that were in New Inquiry thinking like, who is this person, but actually that they are as much part of New Inquiry as anyone else on earth is, and that if they do well enough, if the bar is high enough, that they'll get in. There was a more of a meritocratic sense of when you submit that it wasn't about any social gravity that you had within the group. And so in that sense, we've done extremely well with open submissions, and many of our editors are people who submitted blind through our submissions email. And I should say that we have like 30 editors. So,
Jim, do I come in?
Yeah.
this is a question about the medium, because one thing that's interesting here is that two of you at the moment are entirely online, or the publications are, and you say that you don't want New Inquiry ever to be in print. Could you imagine Useless Press creating a print version of what it does? What are the pros and cons of online versus print? Because Rachel can talk about a global audience, which she even can interact with in a way I assume that Jon Baskin at the point can't. So that was my question about online and print, because it's just a different world now.
Yeah, sure. I mean, so I'll just, well, it's an interesting question. I mean, some of the things that, like, for example, the last project that we did that was, you know, this real-time novel writing project, we are, in fact, going to, like, make a real, you know, we're going to print that book out and sell it to people, you know. But, like, you know, in a very limited way. But I think,
all
like,
the profits go to ACLU, so right. I really encourage you.
But it's like, we have no idea how to, like, make a book, you know? like
which is why all the profits are going to ACLU.
So it's like, but I think we're really interested in doing stuff like, I mean, rather than saying, like, we're going to do projects that are printed, I'm going to say that, like, a lot of our projects are going to involve something that happens, like, in the real world, you know? In different ways, you know?
In another sense, the question doesn't even make sense, right? Because, like, the database for the book, the database that we're working with to, like, create the materials in the book is, like, it's, like, so big that, like, Sam couldn't even, like, send it to me, you know? So I mean, we could print that, and that would be, like, a hilarious thing to do. But like, meaningfully, no, that could not exist offline.
And I'll just say, the point is online, and I have no particular, like, it was never a goal to us to be in print. That's not necessarily, like, I think people reading us online or in print, it's indifferent to me. I do think as editors, there's something I find that when we are putting together a print issue, there's a kind of care and concentration on both the individual articles and the way that the articles fit together and make a kind of statement as a whole that I enjoy, and that, you know, I hope the people that read it in print enjoy.
Good. I wanted to read you a very brief quotation from the poet William Carlos Williams, which is written, of course, a very long time ago, about 80 years ago. He was talking about his own involvement in a little magazine called Pagany, which was a short-lived but very influential literary magazine. And of course, inevitably, Williams was very deeply invested in this magazine for a while. And he said that... called The Little Magazine, and he thought, in this sense, Pagany was entirely characteristic right at this moment. He called it a miscellany. And in using the word miscellany, he intended a magazine that would represent, I'm reading his words, in effect, the mix of things, good and bad, high and low, that together offered a picture, even an embodiment of American culture as it actually exists. High and low, good and bad, right? Right. Not only a representation of the culture, but an embodiment of the culture. And he felt that was in some ways, you know, the signal mission of the little magazine. What differentiated the little magazine from commercial magazines, magazines with other kinds of ambitions or pretensions, however you want to see that. I just thought to put that to you and think whether it resonates in any way with your own sense of mission. You know, it is a kind of a purpose to think about one's magazine in that way. It's not a way I could ever think of my own magazine, because for temperamental reasons, you know, I simply couldn't. You know, just wouldn't be something I could do. But of course, I honor the idea, you know, coming from Williams. And so anyway, there's a thought.
I'd love to jump in on that because I think it helps to clarify something that I meant when I said I didn't ever want New Inquiry to be in print. And again, it's not up to me anymore. But I think that when New Inquiry has been at its best, part of the way that it was structured was that it was dissensus-based and not consensus-based. So the idea is that you'd bring in people that per se had different points of view and per se had came from different areas and probably you had no reason to believe would like each other. And the if they brought in something, it wasn't a matter of everyone agreeing that it was like up to New Inquiry's standards. It was about can anyone make a good enough case against it? And then if not, it went up. And the greatness of that was, and I think when New Inquiry was, I think this was a more representative New Inquiry a few years ago, was that it was a place where there were like, it was a very mixed bag and there were a lot of interesting mistakes, which is to say that, you know, our mistakes weren't made because anyone was playing it safe or anyone was trying to toe the line. Our mistakes were that it was just a dumb, like, but ambitious thing that didn't land. And there was always mixed in with that greatness. And there was audiences that could be found that would identify with some subset of what was happening at New Inquiry and another that didn't. And we had blogs. And it was about just abundance and not... and not being formally constrained by the print material where suddenly you're making a statement with what you put out. And I never felt as editor-in-chief that I was actually in control of that statement, that it was that there was no statement to New Inquiry other than just pure reflection at all times of the world that we were living in and a growing group of people with something to say and taking advantage of the platform. And that's something that that can be bad. It can be badly done. And I think that it was very well done with us. And I don't know of anything else quite like it right now, but I identify very much with what William Carlos Williams said, and it's very much my temperament to want to kind of just let the freak flag fly of every little magazine out there.
Anybody else want to pick that up? We don't have to, but
I mean,
great answer.
Chicago must believe it.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I would say I find that characterization of little magazines objectionable in two ways. First of all, it just seems strange as an aspiration to want to embody what's bad in your culture. That doesn't make sense to me. Yeah, but why not just good? But second of all, I mean, I just think little magazines are the last places that embody all of what's good and bad in the American culture. They embody often what's good and bad about a subculture or about a small niche of people who have decided to do something, and inevitably they're going to embody the negative side of whatever those people believe, as well as the positive, probably against their best intentions. But it strikes me that it's actually much more likely that a heavily commercial magazine would embody what's good and bad in the culture than a small magazine.
Great answer. Yeah. Well, this is a somewhat related question, as it's for all of you. In some ways, I think I know the answer to the question where an interactive project would be concerned, but I would like to hear from you guys as well on this. But I want to first hear from Jon and Rachel. Really, it has to do with the question of the kind of hands-on work that you do as editors of a magazine, or directors of an interactive site or project, because you know that's sometimes a contentious matter among magazine editors, and very often it's a matter of very considerable contention as between authors and editors, and I know this to be the case. Not just certainly at little magazines, but at a lot of the big national magazines that I myself often write for, a very big issue. And so I thought to ask you about that, the kind of, well, let's say hands-on work, the kind of revision work, in some cases unto the point of rewriting, that editors are sometimes, you know, is either compelled or inclined to do on material that they want to go forward with, you know, not simply to reject. Anyway, your experience of that, or your sense of that.
Hi. Yes. So it's different for every magazine, but I think that New Inquiry is, even though I present it as sort of this kind of open space, I think it requires way more work to keep, to maintain a high standard, given the sheer diversity of talent, the sheer diversity of vision of everyone involved. The one way to run a little magazine as an editor is to have a vision, and to kind of carry that vision down and attract people that align with that vision, and to sort of be the gatekeeper of what actually makes it in print. That strikes me as easier, although, you know, people can disagree with me, than what the way that New Inquiry is hands-on. And that is, I think that we have five elements that are essential to making it work. One is basically the editor-in-chief, who is in essence really just a manager, and the manager is not sort of taking visions, taking the editorial directive from on high, but instead being able to facilitate a vast group of people, some of whom are globally situated, and make sure that they are represented, that the things they want to have happen do happen, that if they need to work collaboratively, that you mobilize the group of people that need to make it happen to actually build trust of people who are ideological enemies to work together. And, you know, just to briefly respond to John, I mean, I don't think New Inquiry embodies the worst of culture. I think that it is the best, but I think that it's not about, there's no sense of like high culture and low culture. It's about, you know, the most interesting and useful take on any of these, or the most worthwhile take on even low culture, or what's bad in an American culture. And then there's the designer, who makes it look beautiful and makes it look real. And that's a huge amount of work. We have every issue is designed by Imker. Every article is designed and illustrated. An editor to make sure the quality control is of the language of the prose reaches a standard, and that has been one of our great assets. And then, a workhorse, somebody who's willing to put it online, to maintain our social media, to fix mistakes as they come, to do the technical fixing as it happens. And then, of course, you know, a group of, you know, anywhere between 10 to 30 people who are consistently interesting, that have ideas, that meet each other's standards, that raise the bar for one another, and who continue to want to be involved. It is an excessive amount of time commitment and work, and sort of baroque loyalty to the project to make it exist year after year. So, I mean, the hands-on is that, and from my perspective, it's merely about, you know, it was the matter of just making sure every single idea that happened didn't get sort of sent into the void, which is always a risk when you're doing a group project that isn't paid and that isn't structured.
So, yeah, we do a lot of hands-on editing at the point, and it's very stressful and emotionally taxing in ways I would have never anticipated when I started a magazine. I guess just one thing I could say specifically that I think is often an issue with little magazines is it's related, so much of the editing process is related to a bigger issue, which is audience. And you work with a lot of people who come from academia, and they have a sense of how to express their ideas and a sense of how to write and the kind of attention they expect to be placed on their writing, which may be different from the kind of accessibility or the kind of readership that we at the point that you at your little magazine are trying to reach, even though, you know, and so a lot of the arguments in some cases will come down to you know, will come down to that question of you having to say, look, this isn't, it may be very smart what you've just written and very and intelligible to your community that you're used to writing for, but it's not intelligible to ours. And sometimes what you find after that process is that underneath the jargon or the language, they actually have nothing to say. Other times you find that there's something very interesting there that you just needed to strip away. And that conversation, it's very stressful, can also be extremely rewarding. I mean, when you actually feel like you've helped someone bring an idea out and gotten it to a place where it can be understood by, you know, my parents, for instance, that's something I really, you know, you feel good about.
Well, yeah, so for us, it's like a tremendous amount of work to do each project. And like, you know, the people that we're working with have like different technical backgrounds. I mean, we're trying to work with people who like really don't know like what they're doing, you know, basically. So that, and we're trying to fill in the gaps, you know? So
or they know very well what they're doing on some level, right, but perhaps not on the level of the technical realization. Although that might be heterogeneous too at one point. Anyway.
So it's like, I don't know, like, you know, we sort of look at ourselves as editors still, but like, I don't know if, I mean, it's like a little bit up for, I think, debate if like what our work is, if our work is in fact editorial or if it's more like we're producers or we're more collaborators, you know, like artistic collaborators. I like the word editor though, even though it's like not exactly correct, you know.
Well, I mean, you know, despite what John just said, I mean, like, there's the sense that, like, you know, like, writers kind of know how writing works as a kind of medium in a way that, like, some of our collaborators don't know how the medium in which their project is being realized, like, work in the same way. It might be that some writers don't actually know how writing works and they just like, you know, do a bunch of stuff and then the editors kind of put it together. But like, this is like true, I think, in a more profound way. I don't know. I mean, I think there's also an interesting question mark again about this thing, about this aspect of the project of like, you know, writers also have maybe especially in little magazines, some of them don't, you know, but at a certain point, writers have the experience of other editors. They kind of have an expectation about what the role that they're playing is and what the role that the editor is going to play is. And there's a kind of, you know, there's there's a time frame, there's a kind of emotional exchange, there's a sense about like what, you know, what is a reasonable way to act and what is not a reasonable way to act. It's constantly being violated, but it's there, you know? And I think like on our project, I mean, we're really making it up as we go along on our projects, right? I mean, yeah. I think that like the last project we did, actually, one of the things that was sort of wonderful about it, right, or that was sort of wonderful for me, but I think very stressful for everybody, was that it was like, it was really not clear what Josh Cohen's role was exactly, right? Like, he was, in some ways, he was a collaborator on the project, right? But like, in some ways, he was like the like raw material of the project, right? That it was,
or the performer, you know? But right, like, so in that case, like, he just sat there and wrote, you know, like, and like, we made the whole website and did everything, you know. And some of the other things, it's like the collaborator is actually producing sort of the thing that other people are seeing. I think Josh was more of like our victim.
Yeah. And
you know, if that was.
But it was never really clear, I think, to anybody, and hopefully it never will be, like to what extent he was, you know, he was collaborating in his own victimhood, and to what extent that was, you know, to what extent he had his entire own agenda in that project, sure. How identified, you know, he and Useless Press were. And that was like, that would like created some really interesting scenarios, I think. I mean, it was like, really, like, to me, one of the best things about the project was to read kind of like, to read Josh's kind of like, you know, account and sort of self-justification for this like sort of terrible experience that he was going through in the media coverage of it, you know?
Right. Yeah.
I think I'll ask one more question just for the moment before giving people an opportunity to pitch some questions to the panel. There is a sense that some people in the little magazine world have, that there is a sort of, and has always been, a sort of an unbridgeable gap between people, readers, audience members, who are interested in literature and the arts on the one hand, and other people who are interested in politics and culture on the other. Now, obviously, certain magazines like my own don't really observe any such gap, but many magazines do. Many of the most sort of enduring, long-standing little magazines have chosen to go one way or the other. And I wonder if you have a sense in your work with your own contributors and work with your own audience members in some cases, because you do have a sense, and certainly in the way that Rachel described her magazine, of working very closely with within a community of people, that there is such a gap, and that you have to negotiate it and think about it as you decide what you want to sort of include in your magazine. Or your project. Yes. Again, I don't know if it's...
The Wi-Fi here isn't great, but I had a thing written out by Lionel Trilling that I really like in his introduction to a collection from the Partisan Review, where he says, in essence, you know, whether we like it or not, our fate is political, and... be it that we're interested in art or in, oh, I think I can find it. Pardon me. Okay, well, anyway, I'll just paraphrase. That our fate is political, and that whether, like, you know, he has that phrase, the bloody crossroads where literature and politics meet, but it's not, I guess Jon was reminding me yesterday that I guess during Occupy, The Point had a fundraiser in which I apparently antagonistically came up to him and was like, what are your politics? Or whatever. And I mean, it's just
you.
but I think that... I mean, I think that reveals, you know, that's a regrettable, I remember that happening, regrettably, and I think that it's not that simple, but there are, I think when Jon says that he wants to take a more philosophical approach, that doesn't make it any less political, and Useless Press is no less political, and New Inquiry is no less political for our shifting focus in either, you know, dealing with data or art or popular culture or so on. And I think part of what makes, something that I think that this panel challenges is the category of the little magazine. And I wanna explore the idea that this notion of the revival of the little magazine serves nostalgia and sort of the recognition of previous generations, because it's actually disorienting what's really happening, which is maybe not an emergence of little magazines, but something totally new that requires a totally different framing category. But maybe one thing that is consistent is doing something that exists largely in the gift economy and not in the commerce economy, or not in the fiscal economy, where there are stakes, and those stakes are political, and people give a shit, and that sort of passion and struggle is in the very DNA of all of these projects in whatever medium they exist, and that emanates from a politics. I don't know if that's articulate.
Okay. I don't know if this really speaks to the original question, but I mean, my goal was, when I brought that up, was not to deny that the point is political or that all of our articles have political implications, because I totally agree with that, or that there's some kind, and I'm not trying to posit some kind of opposition between philosophical thinking and political thinking. It was only to say that I think there are lots of different ways one a magazine can be political. The most common way that a small magazine is political is by setting out a specific political agenda or aligning oneself with a specific political party, and then pushing, taking material, whether it's literature or articles about literature or articles about society or articles about culture, and finding ways for those articles to speak to that agenda or to forward it. That's the thing that we try to avoid doing at the point. It's not to deny that any of the articles are political, or that even that we as editors have a certain politics, but that there is an attempt within the magazine to say that art and culture and society, all these things express lots of political ideas that can be in opposition to each other and can still be coherent and interesting to put into conversation with each other, and that that's one of the goals of the magazine, of the point, as a small magazine, that I think may distinguish it from some other small magazines.
Well, we'd be happy to have the panelists take some questions if you like. Yes, please.
I wanted to ask Rachel Rosenfelt how she's able to get ideological enemies to work together, because just thinking about things that happen in my own life, you know, I once got slammed by someone on Facebook because she didn't like the way I defined intersectional feminism, and I was called all kinds of names, and so, you know, I was thinking, if you're able to do that, maybe the State Department ought to hire you, and if you can give if you can give some examples of how you've been able to do that and the results, and then maybe an example of when you tried to do that and it didn't work.
Sure, I mean, easily. I think that this was sort of the built-in limit in my vision for New Inquiry, was that part of the way that it ended up working was there was a lot of trust in me to be able to disagree, or not even like sort of take the work that, you know, once somebody was part of New Inquiry, that they were then per se, as far as I was concerned, the equal to everyone else, and I would advocate for them, and others would tolerate that because I advocated for them as well. And so everyone's project got realized. It ended up being like this, what's it called when it funnels? What's the word I'm thinking of?
Bottleneck?
Yeah, bottlenecked emotionally, because, you know, a lot of that sort of like the, you know, like, very principled opposition to what other people were doing would be voiced to me, and then I would be the one in the position to kind of talk down and then to facilitate. An example of a moment when it was not feasible, and I think an example of how I think New Inquiry was successful in this, was when Occupy happened. A lot of the political differences between everybody really surfaced, and it became extremely high stakes. We had, you know, socialists and black blockers and people who, you know, didn't want New Inquiry to be political at all, and people that were out on the street every day. And the decision that I made was that New Inquiry would not publish about Occupy at all, and that everybody had to write for other magazines if they were interested in saying anything about it, because otherwise we'd tear ourselves apart. And that was, I think, at that moment, very wise. And it helped us stay together, and it helped us all individually have influence in other platforms. But I think that, you know, to speak to the conversation that we had last night, I think that, you know, as New Inquiry has increasingly become, and I'm proud to say, you know, one of the more racially diverse and globally diverse magazines out there in this category, the stakes are increasingly high for, you know, New Inquiry to stand for something, because there's a need for it to stand for, it's a need for it to, like, in the space it occupies, stand for something very specific in, particularly with regard to racial politics and queer politics and anti-capitalist politics. But, and for that reason, it no longer has, I don't think that it is, it's no longer under my control, and I don't think that ideological enemies can coexist in what New Inquiry is today, and I think that that's probably a good thing for the role it plays in the world of ideas, but it's a bad thing in the sense that I wished it continued to be as surprising as I liked to think it was years ago.
Rachel, I just have to ask you one question. Mm. So I want to visualize the thing myself. Mm. When you say, when people get to be a part of New Inquiry, right, certain things follow from that. I'm not sure I'm actually seeing what that entails. Do people get to be, or initially at least, did people get to be a part of New Inquiry by assembling once a week at an editorial site and fighting things out together on the way to the assembling of an issue? Or, I mean, how do they get to be a part of New Inquiry?
Well, again, this is speaking historically. I think that for the years that I was running it, was basically, it was only ever growing. There was only ever more positions open for people. And the idea was, if I may, I'll use the example of Alix Rule here at the end of the table. I had read her essay with David Lavigne, as opposed to Sam Lavigne, called International Art English in Triple Canopy. And she was doing something totally new that I didn't see anyone else doing, where she was taking data and art criticism and satire and making this really powerful essay. And so I thought, well, if New Inquiry is not the place for her, then we're doing something wrong, and it has to now accommodate this person if I can convince her to be part of it. And then basically I would recruit her, and then once, theoretically, once she's part of it, any idea she has at all, I would help make happen, and the site would publish, and it would get that exposure, and that's what it means to be part of it. She could commission people she wanted. That didn't make them part of the staff or the group of editors. But once you were an editor, there's a sense of, you know, even if you're online and you're not at the weekly meetings, if there's something you want to have happen, it happens because you've crossed that threshold. That's like the most important deciding moment. The most important editorial intervention I make is recruiting. And so that, again, this is not, I mean, I think that it's, I think that something like Useless Press is not right for what New Inquiry is now, but years ago might have been. And that's sort of what it looks, is that, I mean, an accurate depiction of, I mean, that's sort of what it looked like. And there's a limit to that. There's a limit to how long that can last. And, the first time I ever met Mark Greif, I remember him saying how worried he was for me that I was alone, that I was the one person doing it. And it was because I was alone that I sort of was able to I could just decide, and that's what happened. And the more labor equity people put into it, the less alone I was, and the less I was able to determine, you know, this person is recruited, this person has power, and that's what I say. It's horizontal because I say so. And that's that was the only way that it could have worked, and it worked quite well for, you know, about 5 years.
If anyone else kind of wants to jump in there, or we can just go pick another question. Mark, sorry.
Yeah. Well, I have a. Oh wow! Yeah, boy, that's the quiet mic. This thing is, it's electrical. I've just found the panel incredibly clarifying, actually, the whole way through, and for a lot of things about questions I've always had, things I've always wondered about, having to do with small magazines or whatever this suite or constellation of things are that we're calling or miscalling small magazines. And the first of them was really listening to all of you speak, the ability to see what it is that unifies the desire to discover the forms of the good and the truth or the true, and to do the thing that's stupid, or as Rachel said, very loftily, I can't imagine a sense of purpose, having a sense of purpose, which is funny because I, in the early days, you know, if I had described Rachel Rosenfelt of the New Inquiry to people, I would be like, oh, she's a messianic figure, kind of a, you know, visionary. Nothing will stop her and her single-minded vision. And, you know, what unites these things seems to be something like a will to the anti-utilitarian, the anti-professional, the anti-profitable, letting your freak flag fly. Glad to hear David Crosby in the room. But, yeah, it made me wonder because I... this question, I mean, I would think of it as Socratic, right? There's a sense in which he was against writing anything down, which perhaps was wiser than any of the rest of us. But Socrates, in a sense, was like the first small magazine editor insofar as he would like walk around and antagonize people. And when they would say, well, what? He'd be like, I don't know, right? But on this question of the good and the stupid as both representing alternatives to all of the things which we're told are good, useful, and commonplace, I guess in the N plus one experience, we used to just say we were incompetent. And this always made sense to us. We'd be like, we're a very incompetent magazine, as if that would, you know. But it didn't make sense to many of the people whom we were asking to subscribe, to write about it elsewhere, etc. And over the years, I think I've had, I've always felt overwhelmed by the feeling of corruption and the kind of forces of corruption, corruption of ideas, corruption of the project associated with, you know, the effort to become a real magazine or to professionalize. And it's always been very hard to explain to people why you wouldn't want to become professional or successful, et cetera. Especially since if people said, well, don't you want to sell issues? I would always say, yes, I would love people to read the thing. And so, sorry, that was too long. But my fundamental question is, for each of you, what are the sources, the kind of most active sources of corruption, threatened corruption, that you feel in your efforts to make the thing that you want to make?
That's a great question. I feel like... I feel like we've had, we're the newest, so we should get to go last. But I would say that it's also, you know, like Useless Press has been live for, what, like 4 months?
Yeah.
So it's like a little bit like the beginning of the relationship where it's like you can't imagine how it's going to fail yet.
Although like the thing that's...
give it like 1.5 months.
It's like, I don't know anymore. Things are... No, but I mean, I think there's like, you know, one thing that always happens when you do things that are a little bit satirical is that some people don't understand that it's a satire. That's the best, but it's really great, you know, but like, so for that, you know, live streaming, the novelist thing, like someone was like, oh my God, I'm so excited about this as like a platform. Like, what are your plans to get, you know, venture capital funding, you know? And I don't think that's an actual threat, you know, for us, because I don't think we're just gonna be like, yes, let's let's try to get VC funding for this thing that's a joke. But you know, I guess it would ruin things if we did. But yeah, I think that there's like, you know, a lot of the things that we do, despite their fundamental inutility, actually do have like practical application, because they're technical. And I think that is like kind of, you know, if we do decide that we need funding at some point, that, you know, I think that's a sort of existential threat that we would, you know, go down that road and then become something that we really don't want to be, you know.
So yeah, I mean, I think the point probably still needs to get considerably more successful before we face some of the serious forms of corruption you're probably thinking about. I mean, I think though there's always like an internal threat of corruption with a small magazine, in the sense that you know, you start with something you want to say, in the first couple issues, and, as you grow, there's the attempt to balance bringing in new voices and being genuinely open to kinds of articles that might be very different from the kinds of articles you started out with or come from different points of view. And you need to balance that with, at the same time, not wanting your magazine to start to feel like everything else, and having some sense that, you know, the initial mission is still there to some degree. And I just think, I mean, I think that's just an endemic challenge to anyone who's involved in a magazine, probably even big magazines, but especially with small magazines, because you do start out often with a very sharp sense of, like, as you said, like something that's missing or something that you want to do. And then you have to keep that from becoming just repetitive, but also, you know, hold on to it in some sense, I think.
Yeah, I mean, I think that clarify just a little, something I had said earlier, that I think by external metrics, New Inquiry is a higher quality magazine and better than it's ever been. And every time I look at it, I'm shocked. Like, I'm just like, wow, cool. I can't believe I'm part of this. But the corruption, I think, has been more internal, which is, you know, it's resistant to funding, so we've given up on that. We, like, you know, no one will show up to flatter a funder, and nobody will do anything that fulfills the terms of a grant, and I've learned this the hard way. But the thing that used to be, like, that used to drive us and used to be so thrilling was the genuine feeling that success didn't look like anything and failure didn't look like anything, because we didn't set out to do anything in particular. And then I think the corruption came from the visibility. The corruption came from suddenly kind of doing something for its own sake and for the adventure of the thing, and then being very visible, and then suddenly feeling accountable to the people that are involved, and them feeling that you're accountable to them. And then, moreover, if you want to continue to grow and bring in new voices, the lack of understanding, like as Mark said, that you can't really go around calling yourself incompetent, or like success doesn't look like anything. When people come in and they think, well, this is like an opportunity, this is a platform, why aren't I paid for my work? Why, you know, we do pay all of our writers, but then suddenly our editors are feeling exploited, which never was a problem before. So I think that, like, it's just that success starts to look like something to the collective, and then that means you can fall short of it. And that corrupts the spirit of the project, if not the content of what's actually produced.
Another question? Yes, thank you.
I'm glad you started to talk about something which both commercial and non-commercial magazines face. It's the question of money. How do you get it? What do you do with it? And what difference does it make if you don't have any?
Yeah.
Sure. Well, I mean, the first thing to say is that, like, you have to be in a position of privilege already to be working on something that doesn't pay, you know? And so I think that, like, we're in that, you know, like, we're doing this in our spare time, of course, you know, but we're able to do that. You know, that's just something to consider, right? But we don't have any money, and we don't really like have any plans to get any money right now, you know. Unless you do. Do you have any plans to get money?
No, I have no plans to get money. But yeah, I mean, I would echo that. I mean, it's like we were just having this conversation on the phone the other night, you know, like. I don't know, like one of our collaborators was like, how can we get you guys some money? Like, you guys need money, right? And I was like, actually, if you could get us some time, we just need time.
But anyway, the point is, yeah, I guess I sort of said it backward, but it's like, you know, like it's like the quote unquote like nobility of doing it for free basically like comes with certain caveats, which, you know, so that's, and it's a privilege.
Yeah. And I think that the ways that there are to go about getting money are, you know, there's the grant world, which is capricious. It takes a huge amount of time. If you're the sort of person who could write a grant and then fulfill the terms of that grant, you're the sort of person that you might as well just have a damn job on Wall Street or something. Like, I can't imagine doing that. And if you're the sort of magazine that will flatter people who have money as a category of people who tend to be older, then I'm not sure that you're doing something very interesting that's new. And if you're doing something that is commercial and sells ads, then I'm not sure that you're really being that challenging. So there is a huge problem of money, and there's a problem of, with New Inquiry, we're subscriber-based, $2 a month, every month, indefinitely, so that's $24 a year from our subscribers. There was a time where that model looked like the problem is that model works only just enough to get some people to start doing it full time, but then that doesn't give them an actual future. It's not enough money ever to really feel secure and not feel kind of in a constant state of crisis. And it almost would be better if we just had no money and did it totally for free. Or, I mean, and just to everyone here on the internet, lots of money would also be great. I do think, though, that starting out with a lot of money is a curse. And anyone who is given a chunk of money to start a little magazine produces something crappy and useless. And that is...
In the bad way.
In the bad way. And so I think that, like, to have to sort of, like, cobble it together through sheer passion and vision, and to attract people because of passion, and that shared passion yields a more interesting product that hopefully then can sustain however it's possible.
I don't have that much to add, but I guess I would say one thing that might be a little bit against the grain of what's been said so far, which is that for the point, raising money both through Kickstarter and going to donors, and I think was in a lot of ways a really good experience for our magazine. It made us articulate its importance in a way that was accessible to older people, to people that might not be our core readership, but we're still people that we actually would like the magazine to reach. So I don't know. I mean, it's obviously a double-edged sword, and I'm not trying to deny all the dangers of trying to flatter funders and that kind of thing. But I do think there can be something something helpful about really having to explain to a grant organization, for instance, why your magazine is important. It can really make you think about, is it important? and how could it be important?
Can I ask a question?
Okay.
Oh, well, that's an interesting question too.
Yeah.
Why should it have to be important?
Why should it have to be important to a grant giver for it to be worth existing? I mean, I think that there's like...
It doesn't need to be important to a grant giver for it to be worth existing, but I'm just saying when you're talking to people who might not already be excited about your project, it forces you to think about the project and articulate it in a way that is, I think, sometimes helpful.
I think it depends on the kind of project you're doing, and I'd like to sort of like think about, like, you know, the modernist era, and if we imagined all these people that made these magazines articulating what was important about those magazines, they wouldn't do it. Like, I mean,
they wrote manifestos all the time.
Yeah, but they weren't speaking to funders. They weren't asking for money to be like, we want to blow up the world and cleanse. You know, like there's like the manifestos were not grant. I mean. what you need to say that's important about your magazine is like, why is this a social good? And I think that like, it shouldn't, I mean, I think that, that there's some magazines are more clearly social goods than others. And yet I think like even ones that don't, that wouldn't be considered a social good officially by a government or by a grant giving organization are in fact social goods, even that, even because they challenge the status quo, and are upsetting and useless.
Yeah, I guess as in all these things, you know, semantics are important. When you ask the question why it's important for a magazine to be important or to think of itself as important, right? It will sort of depends on what you mean by important. In the context of the the conversation of culture, you might say that the little magazine called Partisan Review, right, knew that it was important at a time when it really was important, when it was a little magazine that affected the conversation of culture pretty much at every level. So it wasn't in that sense a new magazine. It was a magazine that was routinely discovering new writers and bringing them to the attention of a rather wide audience. It was a magazine that was affecting discussion at a very high level, outside the framework of the world of little magazines. So, I mean, this is a very large question, and I hope maybe in a little while, on the next session, Morris Dickstein will talk a little bit about Partisan Review, which he knows a lot about. Well, I want to thank everybody very, very much for this really wonderful session.
And I want to remind everybody that you can buy material objects and books and journals that have been produced for sale as commodity fetish objects at the table being manned. And we'll break for 15 minutes and come back.
Thank you so much. This was so much fun for us.